I
Pinching.
don't think any of those words is a stand-in for any kind of genitalia, so we're good.
Okay.
Blues, 20th century blues, they're getting me down. Who's escaped those weary 20th century blues? Why, if there's a God in the sky, why shouldn't he grin high above this dreary 20th century day?
Welcome to the Vollop, an occasional Vassals of Kingsgrey podcast series. Each episode, I, being a 007, read a story from history to my friends, Casey, Michal, Jock, Amber, and Matt, who have no idea what the topic is going to be about. This is in homage to an amazing podcast series, The Dollop, by Dave Anthony and Gareth Reynolds, which you should totally check out. Guys, do you want to say hi to the listeners? Hey, Michal.
Hey, it's Ink Gaz Rain on the forums.
I actually don't know this. Are you a Dollop listener?
I have listened to occasional episodes of The Dollop.
Ah, okay. So you know the score. I know that, Matt, you are the super fan who got me into The Dollop in the first place.
Well, actually, yeah, by way of hashtag Greg who got me into The Dollop.
Yeah. Casey, does that mean you're also a hashtag Greg contagion victim?
Well, actually, he got really upset one time because I said I got the Dollop fandom from Matt. So he was a little disappointed that I got it from Matt.
Amber, who passed the infection on to you? Was it hashtag Greg or Vali?
I'm pretty sure I was the first one that got it from Greg in the first place.
Oh, so you're
patient
one.
Zero. Okay. Number one, yeah.
And how about you, Jock? Have you listened to the Dollop before?
Yeah.
Okay. Short and sweet and succinct.
You and Matt that told me.
Yeah. Well, anyway, this is a loving homage. We have ripped off their idea shamelessly, but you all should listen to The Dollop with a D. This is, however, a Vollop with a V. And the year is 1922.
Ooh.
Okay.
Ooh. American Ooh. Women are just enjoying the right to vote.
Well, this is a very key intro sentence. Do you know who I'm volloping about, Matt?
No, I just got a date.
Wow. That's good and accurate and interesting. Jean Campbell Harris, who I'm hoping none of you have heard of before, is born in London to...
Oh, he's a distant relation.
Pardon?
He's a distant relation.
To hashtag Greg.
Right.
Is born in London to a major general in the British Army and an incredibly wealthy American heiress. Her maternal grandparents owned a massive paint business in Chicago. She lives in a house.
So this is Downton Abbey?
Kinda, I suppose. Yeah, actually, because that was an American woman. I think it was kind of that era, wasn't it, of like sort of decrepit English but aristo families marrying really rich Americans. Didn't Winston Churchill's mum, she was American, right?
I think so, but the Churchill family goes back way back, right?
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, they're not as old as some, but yeah, they'll do. Jean Campbell Harris lived in a grand house with lots of servants close to where John Lewis is today in Oxford, so it's like a really, really posh area of London. She would watch the lamps of London being lit by hand every night. There was a cook, a nanny, a parlour maid, an under-parlour maid, three cleaners, a governess, an under-nanny, and a chauffeur. So, you know.
What's an under parlor? There's a parlor person and an under parlor person?
Does that just mean like the assistant?
Oh, okay.
I don't know, like a nanny and an under nanny. I mean, I'm guessing.
How many nannies do you need?
You have one that just takes care of the baby and one that just takes care of the diapers.
Well, maybe they do shift changes, like one does the day and one does the evening.
Or one takes care of the nanny and one takes care of the baby.
I mean, at this point, you need to have servants to take care of the servants, don't you? You know.
No wonder all the aristocracy went poor.
I know. I mean, like, not having grown up with lots and lots of servants, I don't really know how it operates. But nonetheless, the point is she has, like, a fuck ton of money. There was no maternal love, but lots of glamour. Her parents were friends with the ex-Liberal Prime Minister, David Lloyd George. Her godmother's husband was the first Jewish man to be in the cabinet, and then he became Viceroy of India. So she is, like, ridiculously well-connected. And actually, at that period, to be Jewish and to be in the cabinet is very, very unusual. I mean, Disraeli had been our prime minister in the previous century, but he had to convert to Christianity. So this is still a very anti-Semitic period.
And isn't, like, the Viceroy of India, like, a big deal there?
Yeah, I mean, you're basically the Queen's appointed person who's running. And India in those days was, like, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh. I mean, it was, like, you're running a major part of the world. So, yeah, if that's your godmother's husband, that speaks to how well connected you are.
It's so, still a little awkward being like, yeah, go get that colonialism.
Oh dear. So little Jean went to very, very posh prep schools, and at those prep schools she was taught dancing by the same dancing mistress who taught Princesses Elizabeth and Margaret Rose.
God, I hate this girl already. Fuck you and your dancing lessons.
And then she went to boarding school and was utterly miserable. She decided she didn't much like the company of other little girls, and had decided that she'd rather get 0 out of 100 and really show she hadn't tried than to get 20 out of 100 and just be, like, bad.
So did she just miss her nannies and under nannies, and she didn't like regular people?
I think she just didn't like girls. She's like she just preferred the company of men and just being like, and you know, like, girls boarding schools are really bitchy, and really,
I can only imagine.
Yeah, I always say that when I'm in, like, tough business situations, that I survived the sixth form common room of an all girls school, all girls private schools, and that's like Darwinism in action. So I can see her reaction there. This is a quote. I never told anyone I was unhappy. One simply didn't. My mother worked it out on the day she turned up at my boarding school unannounced, and was greeted by the headmistress with some surprise. 2 weeks previously, I had told everyone that my mother had died.
Huh.
Anyway, 1929, the Wall Street crash. Jean's mother loses everything. The Tony house in London has to be sold. Basically, they just have no cash. They move to a country house in Kent. They still have horses, so there's lots of hunting, shooting, and fishing. There's a tennis court. She becomes very good at tennis. And still a few...
Oh, they sound poor as shit, yeah.
Still a few sevens, yeah, but no electricity or heating. She plays a lot of tennis and is seriously considered for Junior Wimbledon. So she actually makes a joke about this, like, how poor they are. And she says... quote, I suppose it was a bit like the Eton boys' story about poverty. The father was poor, the mother was poor, the butler was poor. We used to say that my mother's idea of poverty was going to the Ritz in a bus.
Jesus.
I can't have that. It's a good joke.
But anyway, I mean, I think it's relative poverty. Her parents still had a small flat in London, and her mum had to work there, which must have been a shock. So obviously a woman of that class and time doesn't really have any skill set apart from buying shit. So she became an interior decorator for all her rich friends. But it was the mother's income from interior decorating that kept the family in business. Like, the dad was earning bugger all in the army. So, yeah. Anyway, so she's a woman who's been through at a young age comparative loss of income. No more dancing lessons with the Queen. Okay, so 1937, Jean is 15. She's sent away from school for not having, and she hasn't taken a single exam, so she's got literally no qualifications. She would normally go to finishing school in Switzerland. That's what girls of her class would do in that era. But because war with Hitler was sort of on the horizon, she was sent to live in Paris with a very eccentric pair of old women to learn French, German, and Italian fluently. And she stayed there for 2 years and became incredibly fluent.
If she stayed longer, she would have definitely learned German.
Well, yeah, I mean, very nice, Matt, very nice.
Yeah.
But she's eating surrender monkeys. Her father takes her there via Biarritz and Nice. If you know anything about geography of Europe, and you know where London is and where Paris is, to go to the south of France, to Nice and then Biarritz, to get to Paris is like a ludicrous detour. He was evidently squiring women and, to quote Jean, very naughty indeed. In Biarritz, they stayed in a villa owned by friends of her mother, which happened to be also hosting at the same time the Prince of Wales and Mrs. Simpson. So at the age of 15 she had lunch with the Prince of Wales and Mrs. Simpson, who came to lunch in matching tweeds.
Was this before or after they perused the German army and had lunch with Hitler?
probably just slightly before, actually, but certainly at the height of the scandal. So yeah, definitely starting a lifetime where she just happens to bump into very, very influential and famous.
Is she a Forrest Gump kind of character?
Yeah, a little bit, you know, a little bit.
I'm Team Jean. I like this lady.
I like Team Jean. I like anyone who deliberately gets 0 out of 100 in a test and tells people mm-hmm. her mom's died.
I still haven't gotten over dancing lessons, so fuck her.
You'll learn to love it. So in Paris, Jean learns fluent French, good manners, polite conversation, and about art and architecture, aka how to be an aristocratic wife. So by 1939, everyone, however, is worried about the war, and Jean has to return to England. So the family house in the country is requisitioned by the army. The elder brother that she has is sent to America to join the family business in Chicago. The younger brother goes to the army. Her mother and flat live in London. And the big question is what to do with Jean, because she's too young to enlist. She's not quite 18. She can't really go back to school. She doesn't have any qualifications. She's not really designed for a job. So she becomes what in those days was known as a land girl. And these were women replacing men who'd been called up to the army. So the women started doing the agricultural work, but rather than just going on some, you know, like bog standard farm where Varley's ancestors come from in like north of England, she ended up working on the farm owned by the former Prime Minister Lord Lloyd George in Surrey. And she was billeted
Lloyd George.
He was Prime Minister during World War One, and it was very scandalous because at the time all of London knew that he had a mistress who was his young secretary, and she was billeted with the mistress. So very scandalous.
Didn't everyone have mistresses back then?
Yeah, but I don't think someone with quite that age gap. And
what's the point of a mistress then?
Yeah, I know, in different social class. She was so bored, she asked to do a secretarial course in London and was given permission. And then by October 1940, Jean turns 19 and she can finally join the war effort. Now, this is the bit where the story gets cool. So, obviously, she has no actual formal qualifications, but she is fluent in French, German and Italian, which happen to be the countries we're fighting. So she's recruited to work at Bletchley Park, which is where Britain's code-breaking effort was taking place, where Alan Turing is creating computers to decode German signals, where we've got the Enigma machine. So she has no formal qualifications, but, you know, somehow this education that was meant to make her a posh bride just makes her absolutely perfect for translating naval codes from Germany. She is not formally vetted. Those of you familiar with the Cambridge spies will be unsurprised to hear. Being posh and well-connected, it's assumed she's okay.
Oh, yeah. No background check. No nothing. We're fine. Totally fine.
It's just like, this is the Arrested Development portion when, like, Ron Howard's voice says, she was not okay.
But it's just, like, amazing to me that you could be handling, like the most high-level naval encryptions at the age of 18 with, like, no education to speak of. And, just my dad knows her dad. He's all right. He's one of us, you know.
But wasn't that, like, kind of assumed on both sides? Like, the British were using the same, like, kind of thing in Germany, but they didn't think it would happen in Britain? Like, I don't understand it.
Yeah. Right?
Were there, like, zero vetting going on all sides, but it's like, oh, they come from a good German family, they'll be loyal Germans, and they're, like, spying for the English and vice versa.
I mean, like, everything is just so frippin' amateur in those days. It's just amazing to me.
Yeah, turns out classism makes people make really dumb decisions.
I know. Anyway, Jean describes life at Bletchley as being pretty tedious. Shift work, billeted with locals, bad food, mixed with going up to London to dance all night at posh dance clubs that sound like something out of Brideshead Revisited, and then taking the first milk train back to Bletchley and going back to work. In 1941, Jean was presented to the Queen at Queen Charlotte's Ball, which is a very posh coming out party for young debutantes. She dated some boys, but was resolutely a virgin, fending off their attacks. This was apparently something you did. And all the people that she works with in Bletchley are very, very posh indeed. So one of them is Sally Astor, who will go on to be Prime Minister David Cameron's mother-in-law. So class system still alive and well in Britain. Sally's mother was also mistress to Max Beaverbrook, who owned all the newspapers at the time.
Sorry, what was that?
Max Beaverbrook. So he was like the Rupert Murdoch of the day. He owned lots of newspapers.
She doesn't even think that's funny.
I know.
That's amazing.
She said Beaverbrook twice.
Why is that not funny? Why is that funny?
Beaver is another word for the Wajin, the female Wajin in the United States.
The Wajin?
I've never heard of that before.
The Wajin?
Even I've heard of that.
Vajin. That's the Bachelor way of saying it, or that one person on the Vast Bachelor said.
Okay, well, let me say it third time for the charm. Sally's mother was also the mistress of Max Beaverbrook, who would always try and get Jean alone and sort of get information and gossip about Lloyd George's mistress. Another of the friends she made at Bletchley was Al Friendly, who went on to be the editor of the Washington Post. So, yeah. Like,
sounds like a nice guy.
Ridiculously well-connected. She doesn't say a lot about what she did specifically at Bletchley and says that secrecy was so drummed into them that it was a hard habit to break. Even, you know, before her death, sort of many, many years later, she was very quiet about what she did. But we do know that it was translating German naval codes. So well done, Jean. The war ends and Jean is 21. She moves to Paris, which has a real party war atmosphere, sort of end of the war, everyone celebrating. And she works for an organization putting Europe's inland transport back together. Her job is basically to find the execs' houses and arrange parties at the Hotel Crillon and the Ritz. So again,
sounds rough.
Yeah, it's just like one of these lives that you read where someone basically just, you know, floats along on this cloud of, you know, great, I don't know, beautiful good luck. She moves
come
in
on
with
guys, this is the greatest generation. Everyone was just hardworking and whatever.
Yeah,
nobody
was hard.
Is this the time period America was great? I don't know.
It has the name great in the generation name, Casey, so yeah.
I mean, she had helped the war effort by the time she was 21, so that's something, I suppose.
That's true. I haven't done that.
Yeah, you know. She moves in with Monsieur Lefranc and his daughter Solange, incredibly rich friends of her father, and lives an incredibly glamorous life. She falls in love with a man who, in her autobiography, she calls the American. He takes her to visit her cousins south of France. Basically, she just has this really beautiful life, but all of her friends are getting married to very glamorous people, to dukes and industrial magnates, and basically settling into conventional lives as wives and society hostesses. But Jean doesn't get married because she's in love with the American, and I think this is kind of the key to why her life becomes interesting, because even after Bletchley, she could have just had a very conventional life, but she doesn't. So in 1948, she returns to London. She goes to work for a man called Viscount Hinchinbrook. Pause for Varley to laugh. Hinchinbrook.
Pinchinbrook?
Hinchinbrook.
Hinchin.
I don't think any of those words is a stand-in for any kind of genitalia, so we're good.
Okay.
Just well, Hinchinbrook sounds like the German for beaver, so it's basically the German Beaverbrook.
They Beaverbrook and Hinchinbrook. All the Brooks are here. He's a Conservative Party MP, Member of Parliament, so this is her first sort of explicit political exposure. She also canvasses for her friend Sally Astor's husband, Viscount Astor, as he runs for Parliament, going door-to-door in a very, very poor part of London, trying to persuade people to vote for him. And I just have this image of her turning up in a sort of high-rise social housing estate in Peckham, like in the projects, looking very posh with her sort of twin set and pearls and full skirt, and saying, knocking on the door, would you mind voting for Viscount Astor? He's a jolly good chap. What was she thinking? But apparently she had this whole ruse with these like high tower poverty blocks that she would ask everyone for a glass of water in the first few, because people were generally too polite not to let you come in and have a glass of water. And then once she got to the kind of the higher flats, she'd ask if she could use the loo, because by then she needed it. So apparently she was very good at canvassing with poor people. But yeah, there you go.
Or poor people were just dumb and let anyone into their fucking apartment.
Yeah, also true. I think probably still in those days, kind of intimidated by a woman of evidently higher class as well, maybe. Like, couldn't say no to someone who they thought should be naturally in command. It was a really weird period for Britain those days. Mm-hmm. So, in 1950, Jean and the American are holidaying with friends in Spain. One of the girls in their group is Jackie Bouvier, later Kennedy.
Ooh, I know her.
Apparently, she tried to like set her up with her brother, but her brother was like, "Ooh, that I don't like her. She's not very pretty, and her hair's very dry."
Her hair's dry?
Yeah, that was his reason for not like macking on with like Jackie Kennedy.
Oh my god!
I know.
I like my hair like I like my wit dry.
By 1952, Jean is 30 and unmarried, which is, I guess, kind of scandalous. She is sent to New York, where her brother has become a successful Madison Avenue advertising exec. So basically, this is the Mad Men era, right?
Sweet. This is when America was great, right?
Yeah, this is when America was like at least stylish, if not great. She falls in with a very glamorous set. She spends time at her sister-in-law's estate on Long Island. #Greg shout out. and bathes at a private club. So I don't know, Casey, if you want to fill us in on whether Long Island is still like this or Michal. Quote unquote, the beach in East Hampton was strictly for upper class members of private clubs only. No blacks,
sounds right.
No ordinary right. people, other than on a tiny strip at the very end. And it was the same throughout the United States. Still true?
Yeah. East Hampton is pretty much like what Greg calls like the Hampton of the Hamptons. It's where the wealthy people go to the beaches. I've only been there once, actually, since I've been up there. So
yeah, I've never been there, but I do know that there was a service that popped up a couple of years ago to chopper people to East Hampton. Yes. Because, you know, there was just too much traffic in the limo.
Yeah, you can't be on the LIE when there's good, you know, beaching to do.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Let's make America great again. No blacks or poors, right?
Or ordinary people.
Not even poor people. Like, even middle class people at this point, right? I mean,
who serves the rich?
I don't know. But I think it's amazing that this woman who's had dancing lessons with the Queen and has dined with the Prince of Wales and Mrs. Simpson and Jackie Kennedy. Like, she's lived this incredibly privileged life in Europe. She gets to America, and as privileged as she's been in England, she finds America ludicrously classist. I mean,
how?
Well, I guess there wasn't explicit... I mean, in England, there wouldn't have been blacks around, but no one would have had a sign up saying no blacks. So maybe that's the difference, maybe? I don't know. But she points it out. I mean, she says she was shocked. If you read her autobiography, she finds it genuinely shocking. So having been scandalized by Long Island's classism and racism, she then goes to Chicago with a letter of introduction, because apparently that was a thing in those days. And she goes to stay with a family called the Annenbergs, who are apparently like ludicrously rich. Walter Annenberg was a billionaire in the 1950s, when like a billion was like a fuck ton of money. And he would later become Nixon's ambassador to London. So at this point, Jean is still having an affair with the American, but she also meets an Englishman called Alan Barker, who's studying at Yale, and they fall in love. And she leaves New York to marry him. And after a stint being, because he's a teacher, being a master's wife at Eton, they move to Cambridge, where he became headmaster at the Lee School, which is a private boys' school which educated the royals of Bahrain and Tonga, amongst others. They have a son. She seems very happy indeed. And she said, the only sadness is that she couldn't have more children after a difficult first birth. She learns to cook. She amuses herself by gambling on horses and hunting for antiques, and basically settles into, I think, again, this is another point where the Vollop could have ended, because she's now become a very conventional headmaster's wife and, you know, is in a very posh school and could have been very conventional. But this is actually, I think, where the story gets more interesting. So Jean, I think, is basically uneducated but quite smart, and she has this passion for sort of getting involved in doing stuff. So she helps improve the school. She asks for Eton's secondhand boat so that the Lees boys can row. She takes the boys around the museums and colleges of Cambridge to give them a cultural education. And she basically just sort of, you know, gets very involved in the community of the school. This is a good quote that kind of, I think, symbolizes her sense of mischief and unconventionality. For 17 years, we had been at the Lee School, and for 17 years, at every speech day, it had been my job, my only job, to walk around the edge of the indoor swimming pool holding various cups to be presented to the winners of the swimming gala. In my 17th year, when I had paraded around the pool for the final time, with the final cup, I jumped in the swimming pool at the deep end, fully clothed, in my best speech day dress. The masters were astonished, the boys beside themselves with delight. Of course, almost the entire school followed me into quote-unquote save me. Barker wouldn't speak to me for 3 weeks afterwards.
That's what? Really scandalous right there. Jumping into a pool, fully clothed. Ooh.
I know. Well, this is middle class England.
So okay. So this guy, who are we talking about? The Annenberg guy? Because I want to talk about him for just a second.
Go on then.
So he is made a Knight Commander of the Order of the British Empire.
Yeah.
Of the Order of St. Gregory. Gets a bunch of different stuff. You know how he become a millionaire? He was ownership of the Philadelphia Inquirer, TV Guide, the Daily Racing Forum, and 17 Magazine.
You know it's this the TV fucking Guide. Guy, you know it's the TV Guide back in the day.
TV Guide.
There was three channels. They didn't need a fucking TV Guide. What?
Billionaire with a B. Billionaire. 1950 billionaire, which is almost like a bazillionaire now. Whatever comes after billion.
You know, TV Guide was really convenient when you're in a hotel room because you just don't know the channels. That's when I would read the TV Guide.
What comes off to billion?
A little card for you?
I mean, well, I shouldn't. Not when I was a kid.
For TV Guide, so I shouldn't put it down. But like,
wait, you worked for this guy?
Yes, he was a terrible boss.
Really?
I don't know. But I did intern at TV Guide.
Okay, cool. Right. We're now in the late 50s and early 60s, and Jean is in her 40s. And her life hasn't really begun yet. We haven't even got to the good shit. The couple stay for weekends at Clifton House, which is a very swanky country house owned by their friend Viscount Bill Astor and his second wife. We now know it as the hotel where Meghan Markle spent the night before her marriage. But then it was a place known for wild parties and orgies. Jean met Stephen Ward, who you guys might not have heard of, but there was this big scandal in England in the 60s called the Profumo Affair, where basically Stephen Ward was arranging for these hookers to come to Clifton House and sleep with a government minister. And one of the hookers had also slept with a Russian general. So there was this huge Cold War scandal about spy secrets being spilt on the bedroom pillow and stuff.
Was this the one where there's a picture that people think is Prince Philip?
Yes, exactly.
Ah, I remember this from The Crown. Yes.
Yeah, and it's the really famous one with Christine Keeler naked, sitting with a chair, like backwards on the chair. It brought down the government. I mean, this is a major thing at the time, and Jean and her husband were in the house when Profumo Affair was going on, so they always manage, or she always manages to be somewhere interesting. So during the 60s, so Jean's now in her 40s, she also did a lot of voluntary work, serving on the board of a local mother and baby home. And this is the days when if you got knocked up out of wedlock, you might have to, you know, be shunned and go and have your baby in a mother and child home. And she actually would do stuff to try and improve them and was remarkably like forward thinking. Like, she didn't believe all this nonsense about shunning people and shaming them and making them suffer. She volunteered for the United Cambridge Hospital Board. She became a local magistrate, which means that she was like a kind of judge deciding on cases of local disagreement. It's actually quite a powerful judicial position. She became a local councillor, so the people who run local government. She worked really tirelessly on committees. She learned a lot about how you administrate like hospitals, the police, schools. She just became like really interested in, you know, the working life of normal people and what could be done to organize it better, which like she didn't need to have done. And I think, and it was very thankless and very like unpublicized, but it was kind of impressive.
So in the 1950s, we're in late 1950s or so, these were progressive thoughts.
Yeah, like, the 60s.
People shouldn't be shit on.
People shouldn't be shit on. Yeah, but for a woman of her class and wealth to take that interest, I think it's kind of interesting. So this is kind of the problem, I think, with Jean's career, that she had this husband who was very conventional. He was headmaster of like a very good school, but like the top school kind of still, I guess, in England is Eton. And he applied to get the job there and didn't, and sort of kind of never really recovered from that. And basically his career at the age of 50, so this is like early 70s, has peaked. And yet her career is just about to take off, because in May 1971, she becomes mayor of the city of Cambridge, which I guess would be equivalent of, maybe not mayor of New York, mayor of Chicago, but like a tier two city, definitely. I mean, it's like a pretty powerful job. And
Mayor of Boston.
Yeah, so she gets all the ceremonial gowns, she gets to go and open stuff and sit on important committees, and, you know, and he is her number two, like the first husband or whatever. And I think he found it very demeaning in a period of the 70s when it wasn't normal for a man to take that position. So yeah, this is what she says in her autobiography. Barker didn't ever much like playing second fiddle to me. It's pretty difficult for a man to take second place to his wife. Dinners were difficult because I had my place at the head of the table and he would have to wander around the room searching for his name. So yeah.
Sounds rough.
That sounds really great to me, actually. I would love that position.
What, being the sort of being the first lady?
Yeah. Sounds like pretty great.
I don't know. I think it must have been very hard to be enjoying your career taking off and not having a man who supports you. I think that must be really weird at home. And yeah, I'm not sure.
Drama version of the same sort of principle. I think it was called the Prime Minister's Husband.
Hmm.
Well, I think it's weird. I think the difference is like, if you think of when Thatcher became prime minister, her husband was a good deal older than her and very successful in business and very rich. And I think he was just kind of like chilled enough and rich enough to not feel that insecurity. But I think Barker definitely did. So, for instance, he never contributed to her political career. When she needed money to sort of stand for election, she'd have to go on TV quiz shows and try and win prizes to raise the money. It was just this really, really weird setup. He was like, I don't mind you doing it, but I'm not going to contribute one penny to it. And so she just went ahead and did it anyway.
You would think, like, especially for like a British couple, like they'd look to the monarchy and be like, well, if it's good enough for Prince Philip, like I think I could probably manage.
Yeah, exactly. It's just, yeah. And I wonder how different it is today, like for sort of ministers of state who are women, whether they still find it's just a bit weird at home with their hubbies. When her term as mayor was up, Jean tried to become a member of parliament. But in the Conservative Party, even today, that means you have to be selected by your local committee. And the local Conservative Party committees tend to be very old-fashioned, very old, very conservative, as the name suggests, and frankly, quite bigoted party grandees. So they gave her an interview because they had to, but it was incredibly cursory. And one of the questions, so she was asked the question, why do you think there are so few women in parliament, Mrs. Barker? And she responded, because of selection committees like you. So she wasn't selected even to run as a member of parliament.
Yeah, well, you can't answer like that, man. You gotta play a little bit of the game.
Well, I think this is her thing. Like, she could never lie. Like, she always just had to tell her how it was. So in 1975, the Barkers moved to London, where he works at a school, and nothing happens for 5 years. And by this point, she's 60, and she's speaking to Margaret Thatcher and tells her that, you know, she tried to stand as an MP, couldn't get selected because the Conservative Party basically just wouldn't, and that she's very frustrated and feels she still has a contribution to make. And Margaret Thatcher makes her a baroness. And so she becomes Baroness. And normally you take your surname, so she should have been Baroness Barker. But you can actually choose whatever title you get when you become a baron or a baroness. And I think it's telling about her marriage that she actually chooses the name Trumpington, which is the village she lived near in Cambridge. So she's Baroness Trumpington, which is the name that many people know her by. The other village nearby was called 6 Mile Bottom. So she could have been Baroness 6 Mile Bottom.
Oh, that's so much better.
But decided against it.
Yeah, I think I know who she is now.
Exactly. It's because,
does the Beaverbrook run through 6 Mile Bottom?
But she makes a great deal in her autobiography about how it was so close, and it would have tickled her very mightily to be Baroness of 6 Mile Bottom, but she didn't think it would get through the selection committees. So she becomes a baroness at the age of 60 and sits in the House of Lords. Some of her achievements there include becoming the UK representative to the UN Commission on the Status of Women. So she was very active in promoting women's equality, equal laws on marriage and divorce, better healthcare, better human rights. She was absolutely the person who made Sunday trading legal, because when I grew up in England, shops couldn't open on a Sunday. And her point of view was, why can a mother buy gin in a pub but not her baby milk? So she made shops open. Huh. She also worked in the Ministry of Agriculture during the foot and mouth disease crisis and did really good work. And I think one of the most admirable things she did is, because she worked at Bletchley Park with Alan Turing. Alan Turing was famously homosexual at a time when that was legal in England. And he was, despite the fact that he basically was one of the great war heroes of our country, was prosecuted for his homosexuality and was given really humiliating and painful chemical castration treatment. And this drove him effectively kind of to a nervous breakdown, and he committed suicide. But she was the person who lobbied and lobbied for Alan Turing to be given a royal pardon and to be, you know, lauded, and for the government to apologize to him posthumously for this treatment. So Turing was indeed granted a royal pardon in 2013, and that was down to Baroness Trumpington, which is a very great achievement. Her last role was as Baroness in Waiting to the Queen from 1992 to 1997. So she flew around the world and sort of would meet with dignitaries. She was almost like an extraordinary ambassador when very important people came to England. So, for instance, if Trump came on a royal visit, I didn't realize this happened actually. What happens is that the Queen's representative actually goes to Heathrow Airport and greets them as they come off the plane. So that would have been her role.
Yeah, didn't you see the thing of Trump walking in front of the Queen, which was like a big no-no in decorum?
Yeah, don't worry, we'll get him later. That's what the SAS is for.
Treasonous bastard.
She was appointed a Dame Commander of the Royal Victorian Order in 2005. But one of the things for which she is most famous for in England is... So when you sit in the House of Lords, unlike the House of Commons, so the House of Commons is like your House of Representatives and the House of Lords is like your Senate. The House of Representatives, like when you watch parliamentary debates, is full of lots of jeering and hissing and boos, and it's like pantomime, right? It's like really unruly, and that's why we love it. The House of Lords is meant to be distinguished. It's full of the Lords of the Land and the Law Lords and the Law, you know, it's meant to be very distinguished and old people and very posh people. And so there was this guy who was giving this speech about how it was very sad that on this day in 2011, when we're remembering Remembrance Day, how so many of that great generation are looking awfully old and have died. And she basically, so this speech was being given by Lord King of Bridgewater, and basically Baroness Trumpington, who herself was very old at that point, just looked at him and flicked him the V sign in the House of Lords.
I just posted that video in the chat.
Yeah, it's absolutely legendary. God. It's so good. And apparently it was like really famous. Like apparently lots of people would say that she would just sit in the House of Lords, and when people were giving speeches, she would just shout out, "Bollocks!" sort of like from the back benches if someone said something eminently stupid. So this is what made her famous and why people like me would know about her. And because of that, she kind of in her 80s and early 90s would start appearing on like late night satirical political quiz programs. She hosted Have I Got News For You. So she became like this hugely famous person. She also retired from the House of Lords on the 24th of October 2017, one day after her 95th birthday. At the end of December 2017, she was one of the guest editors for BBC Radio 4's prestigious Today programme, which is like a early morning news programme that lots of people listen to. And so she could set the agenda, and basically she chose to talk about her long-standing campaign to legalise brothels. Her entire life's work was about just basically making conditions for women easier and better. So she basically wrote very late in life an autobiography, and she said, quote, "I still have the most wonderful life, and I still behave rather badly, and I still have such fun." She died in her sleep on the 26th of November 2018. Her death was confirmed by her son Adam Barker on Twitter. He wrote, "My mother passed away this afternoon in her sleep. She had a bloody good innings." So, yeah, that's the life of Jean Trumpington.
Yeah, not bad. I found a nice little article on 10 of the best quotes, 11, sorry, of Baroness Trumpington's 11 ballsiest and best quotes.
Go on then.
Should I get into them?
Get into them. Please do.
All right. One on aging. "You don't give a damn about what you say. Other people's opinions matter less, unless they're medical." "On flicking two fingers. It was entirely between him and me, I thought. I wasn't conscious of there being television cameras there. I did that." She repeats the gesture with faux innocence to his face. "His family say he's famous now." "On self-defense. If you are ever attacked in the street, do not shout help. Shout fire. People adore fires and always come rushing. Nobody will come to you if you shout help."
True.
"I'm growing old disgracefully. Is the noble lord aware that at the age of 80, there are very few pleasures left to me, but one of them is passive smoking?" "On her memoir, coming up trumps.
Ooh.
I don't understand all this excitement. I didn't write the damn book, and I haven't read it either."
It was ghostwritten. It's very good, actually. I would highly recommend it.
"I'm daring to contradict Thatcher. I thought, if I'm not true to myself, I might as well not exist. Therefore, I'll say what I think, and if that's wrong, she can sack me. We fought each other verbally, and I would stick to my guns, and she would provoke me on purpose. And that was useful to her. It meant she was ready for other opponents." Okay, so just...
They really loved each other. She hosted Have I Got News For You a few times, and then the week that Margaret Thatcher died, she was invited on to host it. And when she got there, she realized that all the comedians who were the panelists were just going to really rip into Thatcher, because obviously Thatcher was right wing and they tend to be left wing. And she actually walked off the program. She said, "I wouldn't do that to a friend, and I don't care if this screws you up for recording." So a very loyal friend, but an honest friend, which is what you want, right? Okay, continue with the quote.
So the quote on their relationship and why it worked. "In a funny way, she used me because I was never going to agree with her if I didn't agree with her. And so arguing gave her somebody else's point of view."
Yeah, I think that's true. And remember, she didn't just serve in Margaret Thatcher's cabinet. Again, woman with zero qualifications. She actually was a member of the Privy Council. The Privy Council, pause for Matt to make a joke about Lou's.
Nope.
Nope.
Ha ha, it sounds like the bathroom.
Okay. All right. I like this one. I'm suggesting sheep detonate Falcon minefields. My point was that you can put a sheep out of its misery and eat it. You can't do that to a man.
Ooh, that's a bit grim.
On the like Isle of...
That honestly sounds like a quote from A Song of Ice and Fire somewhere.
Yeah. It's a very, like, Tywin or something. Except he'd be like, fuck the guys.
Yeah.
They eat more sheep than... On the Isle of Ely, which is kind of the part of the quote that you already said in your little thing, she said, godforsaken bit of the world, driving from Cambridge, there isn't even a pub on the way. I was Miss Barker then, and they called me Baker all through the interview. At the end, they said, why do you think that you're not in Parliament already? I said, because of selection committees like you, and went out and burst into tears.
Aww.
Aww.
On where she learnt to swear. I used to go into the woods with the local boys and smoke cigarettes.
I bet she learnt more than swearing.
Yeah. Let him into the Beaverbrook, if you know what I mean. On her fellow peers, their lordships do go on and is quite unnecessary. I get very impatient. And that was it.
True that. She's a great woman. And I think it kind of like, you know, if you ever pass a middle-aged, like boring looking middle-class woman in the street, just don't kind of pass judgment or underestimate, because this is a woman whose life, apart from Bletchley, to the age of 60 was basically utterly conventional. And yet from the age of 60 to 95 made this insanely amazing contribution to British public life and just did her best and was curious and put in the hard hours and just turned into this roguish, brilliant member of Parliament. So, you know, I think it's kind of like a beautiful story about how you can be raised in a time when there are zero expectations of you other than to marry well and have kids and just not to be satisfied with that and to do better stuff. So I really love it as a story.
Hmm. Also, well, up when there's zero expectations of you.
She also reminds me a lot of the Queen of Thorns, just like this, like especially when she's in the House of Lords, just sitting there, you know, putting two fingers up to the men, proverbially and literally, not putting up with any shit, speaking truth to power to Margaret Thatcher, who truly was incredibly powerful at the time, and just, you know, just generally being a badass. So I love that.
So here we are.
Yes.
Isn't it sad, though, after all you said she accomplished? Like, we're kind of, well, at least America is kind of like where we are now. We need more of these people to step up.
Can't blame her for everything.
No, I think it's actually remarkably optimistic because it shows that anyone can make a change, that you can have no education. Like, she had no support from her husband and she had no independent money of her own. So she looks incredibly rich, but actually had to really scrimp and save for the £15 to put her name forward to be a councillor. And you can make a change. And it reminds me of, there was this point during the last election where I think Obama said, you know, don't get mad, get a clipboard, you know, just go and canvass and go and get involved. And I think the story of Trumpington is the story of a woman who just got involved at the most unglamorous local level, being a local councillor. It's unpaid, it's shitty. But make a difference. Oh, I love that about her. Like, she could have just had this very luxurious life and just sat back and done nothing. So,
or she could have been a politician that sat back and did nothing, but she put herself forward.
Exactly. And I think for a woman of her generation and sort of raised in her class, to have the kind of, maybe not going to school was a help, right? Just having that independence of thought to realize, just, you know what, every single other person who's with me on this really expensive bit of beach doesn't think it's weird that the black people aren't allowed in, but isn't this weird? And isn't it weird that unwed mothers have to go off into this home and be shunned? What the fuck is that about? And why on earth is Alan Turing still being like persecuted? And like, just common sense, you know, just sheer common sense. And why can't a mum buy milk for her baby and diapers on a Sunday, but the men can all go down the pub? You know, that's just bullshit. So I just really love her very common sense approach to life. I think it's really admirable. Plus, you know, kick-ass naval co-translator in the war. So,
yeah.
Anyway, that's the end of the Vollop, everyone. Thank you for listening. Not truly all about spies this time, although there's still a spy connection, so I'm keeping to my theme. What's up next? I don't know. I mean, I keep on threatening to do the Cambridge spies, but it's always meant to be a surprise. What I would say is to the Vollop community, other people can do Vollops. So, you know, feel free to reverse Vollop away.
I should go back to my Russian history book and, like, pick a story from there, but I would have to take so many notes.
Yeah, what I find is nice is if you read a book or an autobiography and that kind of inspires you. Yeah. But in the meantime, I've been being a 007. Thank you very much to Matt, Amber, Jock, Casey, and Michal. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks for getting squidgy with it.
Thanks, Tina.
Getting squidgy with it.
Ew.
Ew. I feel I need to go take a shower after this podcast.
Na 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 na.
Very weird about the Hamptons is how many people will get their maids or housekeepers to get them, like, say, books. Even like somebody will call me like, I want this book, my maid's gonna go pick it up, and she'll be there in like an hour, and that's what happens.
Using the fake name for Gwyneth Paltrow?
Maybe.
Sneaky girl.
I've been right in front of that building, and I want to, like, trash it, but I've been nice.
One of these days, Casey's just going to snap and go, like, ape shit all over Goop.
I fucking hate Gwyneth Paltrow. I think she should be, and I think she's about to be sued in Europe for basically false advertising on her blog.
Nice. Like,
selling fucking eggs.
Oh, why? Because you're not supposed to put inanimate objects up your, you know, your vagina?
Your yoni, as she calls it.
No strictly animate object there.
The Beaverbrook must be cleaned.
Oh, there's the bumper right there.
The Beaverbrook must be cleaned.
I'm jealous of the fact that you guys can still have affairs. We're stuck with gates over here, and it just doesn't have the same ring.
Damn, Watergate building.
Yep. Mm.
Gates?
Watergate.
Like, oh, any gate. Scandal has to have gate attached to the end of it, and, like, we can't call it, like, the Nixon affair. They used
we have
to.
Gates
like,
too
wasn't
now.
There, like, the XYZ affair back in Adam's day?
Yeah, Teapot Dome scandal. There's, like, all sorts of names, but then, you know, the press, you know, they need to come up with fucking stupid things, like polar vortexes and bombogenesis and whatever gates.
We had a gate over here. Like, so I remember when that phone call was released between Prince Charles and Camilla, and he was like, oh, I really miss you. I just want to be inside you all the time. I just want to be like a tampon. And then he was calling her Squidgy, and it became the Squidgy Gate tapes.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, this is why this man should not be king. It's just fucking moron. Anyway, that's like for a tale for another Vollop.
I want to be the Squidgy in your Beaverbrook.
I don't know why squidgy would be like the appropriate word, because doesn't that imply a kind of,
I don't
like
even know what that means,
a flaccidity? Doesn't that imply like soft and squidgy? Squidgy is like soft
squidgy.
And squishy.
It was she squidgy, then it's good, right? I guess
I'm not sure in the realm of doing sex that squidginess is ever like really a good thing necessarily.
Interesting.
I'm pretty sure when I was a kid I called like the slime I played with or like Play-Doh squidgy, so I don't think
it's not sexy, is it?
It just sounds like onomatopoeia.
Yeah.
Yes, it does, for like a sex noise. Squidgy, 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 squidgy.
Oh. Lovely.
You're going to be a father, Matt.
How do you think I'm going to be a father?
Ba-dum-tsh.
The Beaverbrook must be cleaned. Michal, let me know when you want to do the Russian history thing, because I know that's loaded with levity and, you know.
Oh, my God. I mean,
Cossacks.
It's the craziest. I haven't actually finished the book, because I started reading it, like, 2 years ago, and it's enormous. But, like, every so often I go back to it, and I'm like, what? What'd they do? What? It's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, they had serfs up until the 1900s, so they're good peoples.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, But, like, the beginning is also hilarious. Like, this particular book starts at the beginning of the Romanoff dynasty, and it's just like, oh, well, there was this person called the pretender, and then there was the baby pretender, and then there was his wife, who everyone called the witch, and then there was, like...
This sounds like Fire and Blood.
It really does.
I wonder if George read the same book.
Was he called Perkin the Flea?
I mean, there are, like, there are bizarre names. There are, like, also, like, even just the, you know, I guess technically the famous things, like, I think it was, I don't know, what one of the czar's, like, wife was started out as a prostitute and, like, was led naked into the camp, and, like, he fell in love with her and she became Tsarina, and, you know, it just happens. So, yeah, it was wild. It was, and, like, all their kids died and
infancy, and she was just like, come on, I want to have more babies.
You should totally do a vollop on this. It sounds awesome.
Yeah. I'm going to have to go back and read it. But if anyone wants to read it, it's The Romanoffs by Simon Sebag Montefiore.
Bag. So, yeah, I like his books. I do.
He's very smart.
Yeah. He's married to Santa Sebag Montefiore, who writes really bad books. She's like from an incredibly... So her dad is Palmer Tompkinson, who's Prince Charles's best mate. So that's also a very well-connected family in the Baroness Trumpington mold. But
Well, the Montefiores also, like, they have, like, streets named after them, and...
Yeah, they're seriously rich. I don't aspire to be rich. I just aspire to be poor in the Trumpington way of being poor. I want to be able to go to the Ritz in a bus, you know. I want the butler to be poor. I still think I'd be doing all right. I'm just aspiring to that level of poverty. That's all I hope for.
The Beaverbrook must be cleaned.